to see all of you here this morning. And again, we welcome our guest from Phil's Friends. Thank you for being here. You can actually give the sermon today, so that's great. They don't seem to object to that. That bothers me. Say, okay, you can do that now. There you go. Thank you. Thank you, Judy. I'd like to start today by thanking Cheryl and Kim for the bulletin board. That is an awesome message. And it's something that fits right in with what we're doing today. So thank you very much. Pray, love, and give. And it really talks about what it means as we enter into the season of Lent. As we know, Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. It's hard to believe, but we're already getting ready to walk into that time of Lent. And this year, I want it to be something different. I want it to be something very meaningful. Not that Lent isn't meaningful every year, but this year, I want us to think of those three words, and it's just so appropriate that that's on our bulletin board. Because first of all, Lent is about prayer. And not just repeating prayers, or not just saying we're going to pray every day. Lent is really about how we're going to experience God in a new way. How we're going to experience God in a new way. You know, last week we handed out our Lenten words. The idea that there may be one thing in our life that we have to work on and deal with to deepen our relationship with God. The second part of Lent, though, is love. If truly we deepen our relationship with God, that is reflected in how we love. Because the way we love reveals God's love. The way we love reveals the love that Jesus revealed as he walked this earth and walked to a cross. But then the final word, something we do not hear much about in Lent, and that is give. And that is why today I'm so pleased we're going to hear from Phil's Friends as an opportunity to walk into this world and walk with people. That's what giving in a Christian perspective is all about. It's not simply about making a donation. It's not simply about saying we're going to do good things. Giving means walking with another person. And walking with another person through those difficult times in life, walking with another person when they need that sense of companionship. So again, let's think of those three words today as we walk through our service, and let's think of what they mean for Lent. For Lent is truly a time of prayer, a time of giving, a time of love. And you know, so much of living in faith effectively starts in prayer, in love for one another and our fellow human beings, and in giving. And sometimes we forget the giving part. It's easy to walk into a church on Sunday morning and listen to somebody stand up here and talk for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. The hard part is walking into the world and being someone's companion and being someone's help, someone's advocate, and carrying the face of Jesus into a relationship. That's what we're called to do during Lent. So thank you for those very meaningful words. Very much appreciated. And so let us begin today as we do each time we gather with this powerful affirmation. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Now, we do have several announcements this morning. Donna?
We now have
plans
for the other 5 signs for breakfast. If someone wants to take them, we can make good. Tickets are in the basket back there.
We can't hear you.
Okay. We have the legs for the pancake breakfast signs. We have 5 signs left we need to put out. So if you want to take one of those, just sign where you can put it. The tickets, this basket full of tickets. I gave everybody 5 last week.
Yes, Elaine.
Also those pancake flyers back there, too.
Okay.
All right, very good. Immediately following the meeting today, I'm asking the church council members to convene. It is not a formal meeting. We need to discuss the question of plaques and nameplates, correct? And so we can meet right after the session. Again, it's not a formal meeting, just a sharing of opinions. So we will do that immediately following. Also, the announcements for this week, we have Ash Wednesday services. At 12:30, we will have the imposition of ashes at Church of the Four Seasons. Not a full service, but it will be the person can receive ashes. At 5:30, we will be here for the Ash Wednesday service. And then at 6:30, there's an Ash Wednesday service at Church of the Four Seasons. So there are many ample opportunities to receive ashes, to prepare ourselves for the observance of Lent. And again, it's a very significant time of the year. All right, anyone else this morning? Yes, Tom.
Just a reminder that Tuesday at 7 o'clock is the Fire Territory meeting for the area.
Okay, and that is where?
At the fire station in Porter County side.
Okay, all right. That's, yes, coming Tuesday, that will be the 13th, very important meeting. Encourage all of you to attend. All right, if there are no other announcements, as we walk, yes, Penny.
We could still use a little bit more pancake syrup, maybe.
Really?
So if you can bring them by next Sunday, any unopened ones, then we'll just be up for grabs. But just to make sure, a few more bottles of pancake syrup. And also the next SCC meeting is the week before the 26th, which would be what, the 19th. So SCC is Monday the 19th.
Okay, thank you. So the plan is we're going to like fill a swimming pool with syrup.
Yeah.
Yes, we'll get more syrup. Don't worry about that. No, we want to thank you all, but seriously, bring in syrup if you have it, and looks like it's going to be a great event. All right, as we walked in today, we all were walking in out of our lives. And in those lives, there are many burdens, there are questions, there are concerns. But as we walked in, we want people to feel a certain love and a certain peace in this sanctuary. So let's just take a moment and extend to one another that a sign of Christ's love and Christ's peace.
Good morning.
Morning.
More impressive every week. All right, let us now be about the reason we've gathered here on this beautiful day as we join in our call to worship.
Please stand as you are able for the call to worship. It can be found inside your bulletin. Lord, you have examined me. You know me.
You know me when I sit down and when I stand up. Even from far away, you comprehend my plans.
You surround me. Front and back, you put your hand on me.
That kind of knowledge brings joy to my heart.
Please join us in our opening hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory, page 577, verses 1, 2, and 3, and there will be an introduction.
Tears and doubts, till long and
This is the time when we, as the people of God, talk about how God moves in each of our lives. And sometimes we become confused about this part of United Methodist service. We become confused because it's almost as if we're saying, well, God has touched me this way this week. And that's not the image of God that we have from Scripture. That's not the image of God we have in our tradition. The image of God is that God is present with us every moment. And when we talk about sharing joys or sharing concerns, we are simply testifying to that presence. We're testifying to how we experience God in all of those moments of our life. And when we talk about burdens or concerns, we're not simply saying, God, you need to be aware of this, for God is aware of every human journey, every human mountain we're called to climb. We're saying that we are opening that situation to God for strength, perseverance, and hope, and wisdom. And we're also saying that we are here to build up one another so that no person will ever suffer alone. No person will shed tears alone. If you're part of this community, if you're part of the Christian community, no person will ever suffer alone. And it means that we are called to walk with and be part of one another's lives. And so today I begin with my great joy. I have the opportunity now, I'm teaching a class for people who would like to be lay servant ministers in the United Methodist Church, and I teach it in South Bend on Saturdays, and then we'll be teaching in Hebron again in April. And I am coming to recognize something that sometimes I forget, but it is my joy, and that is how unique the United Methodist Church is. And it's unique because we believe in something very important. We call it the Wesleyan dynamic. We believe that a person should indeed constantly strive to deepen their relationship with God. Now you'll say most religions believe that, right? That we should always work to deepen our relationship with God by coming together in corporate prayer, individual prayer, Holy Communion. That's very true. So we believe in holiness of heart, but we also believe in holiness of life. That means we are called not only to be in that relationship with God, we are called to have that relationship reflected in how we care for one another and how we care for people in the world. That's the beauty of our Wesleyan tradition, and that's my joy today, that we never simply make it about us. We want a relationship with God that's ever deepening, but we also, it's about our relationship with the world and how we reveal God's love to those we encounter. That's my joy this morning. Other joys today. Well, now people, we have to be a little more joyful than this. Well,
joy
Sean,
of parenting.
Yes, we had Stella's birthday last week. Yeah. A good time was had by all. I believe she's now 7.
Yes.
Well, what?
Pizza and beer tonight.
Yep.
For the game.
Pizza at your house? What time do you want us to come by then?
Everybody else but you.
Oh!
Thank you, yeah. I'm going to be at the Buffalo Bills Super Bowl party. I would love to join you, but you know.
I'll be at the Bears.
Yeah. We should join. I mean, if we join with the Bears party and my party, we'll have 4 people there. Yeah. Very good. Yes, Elaine.
I do feel a lot better. I can talk. So.
That's great.
Thank you for all your thoughts and prayers, everybody.
That's awesome. Thank you. All right. Also, Judy had a birthday last week.
But the good thing is I can't remember.
I know. There's some beauty in that, Judy. Yeah, we think that's really good.
Well, it was 82 if I remember.
Yeah. I was just going to say, we just announced how old Stella is. So, and what was your birthday this time?
8! Well, I don't remember.
I didn't think so. Okay. It's more than 7. We'll do it that way. All right, anyone else this morning? Yes.
Yes, I would like prayers for my friend Barry. We prayed for him a while back. He broke his arm on Christmas Day, healed from that, but this past week he and his wife, because he had a heart episode, While he was in the drive-thru at a McDonald's, he ended up driving his car through a fence and down into a lake. Very traumatic experience for both of them. And he's in Munster Community Hospital, and he was supposed to get, if he hasn't already gotten, a pacemaker.
Very good. We'll pray for Barry and Lou.
Thank you.
Very tragic event. Yes?
A very good friend of ours passed away last Monday, Wayne Croner.
Wayne, okay. We'll pray for Wayne's family, certainly. Thanks. Yes, Richie?
Ribbons paved couple weeks ago, she did relate to on shoulder sewers and high before 28 and some days ago they sent her to a official we had.
Okay, and what's her name? Okay. Thank you. Great. All right. Anyone else this morning? If not, let us center ourselves in the presence of a loving God. Holy God, we come to you today and we thank you that you call us to serve in this world. You call us not simply to separate ourselves from the challenges of life, but to walk into those challenges. But to walk into those challenges in ways that carry the message of your Son. The compassion of your love is revealed in your Son to all whom we encounter. We pray today in thanksgiving for the gift of life as we celebrate Stella's birthday and Judy's birthday. We know you are the giver of life, and we just pray that your hand may be upon both of them and that they may feel the power of your love surrounding them. We pray in thanksgiving for Elaine and her recovery. We pray that you'll continue to, in your healing presence, grant her strength and hope and peace and the fullness of health and vitality. We pray for Wayne's family that they may be comforted by the legacy of a life lived well amid the challenges of the human journey, and may they find great peace in the promise of the resurrection. We pray for Richie's friend, for healing, for strength, for comfort, for peace. We pray that your spirit may be upon this situation in ways that truly bring hope and bring contentment. We pray in a very, very special way today for Barry and Lou, undergoing a very tragic accident. We pray now that Barry may feel your healing presence, granting him a certain strength, granting him a certain hope, and granting him wisdom. We pray that Lou may be comforted knowing your hand is upon this situation, that you are guiding them and helping them and sustaining them. We just pray that by the power of your spirit, Barry will know the fullness of health, and Barry and Lou can continue their life together, expressing the joy of your love. We thank you and pray in a special way today for Phil's friends, for Judy and her colleagues, that we just pray that you will continue to guide this ministry, guide this organization as they reach out and help those walking that journey of cancer. May they be sustained in their efforts, covered in your love, and granted your wisdom. And we pray all of these things in the name of your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Join me in the prayer of confession, which can be found inside your bulletin. Holy God,
we rejoice that you call each person by name. Such knowledge is too wonderful to fully understand, yet we still turn from your pathways. Our hearts are hardened by the language of greed, of hate, of envy, and of fear. You are a merciful God. Forgive us for not recognizing that you search the depths of our hearts. Renew us to witness the enduring truth that your grace calls us each to know eternal fellowship with you. In Jesus' name, amen.
We now enter into that time of stillness, and it's a very important time during the service, because in a time of stillness, we experience God. Not the God we want to create, but the God who is. The God who says, be still and know that I am God. The God who is present to you and dwells with you and comforts you and surrounds you. And so today, as we center ourselves in the stillness of our soul, the stillness of our lips, I want you to take one phrase. I want you to take one phrase from Psalm 139 and just put it on your heart. Don't try to analyze it. Don't talk about it. Don't try to rationalize it. But I want you simply to put this on your heart. From Psalm 139, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. Put that phrase on your heart and allow God to speak into your life what that means to you. Again, not in your mind, not with your lips, but God speaking into your heart. Amen. Now I know sometimes when we are growing up in the church and we hear that song, when it says, God, you have searched me, sometimes that can be a little off-putting to people. But as we mature and we recognize that God only searches us because God loves us, then that psalm, that phrase, that text becomes a source of comfort. That if God truly knows us, then God's not going to abandon us. And sometimes in this world, we need to remember that, rely on that, and believe in that. We now enter into what we call prayers of the people, and that's the time we're reminded of who we are as the body of Christ. So please respond, hear our prayer. Holy God of enduring grace, may the Church of your Son be a place of justice, a beacon of hope to a broken world, and a grace-filled institution. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For Salem United Methodist Church and our 180th year of gospel-inspired service, may we continue to be a place of hospitality, a place of fellowship, and a place of grace for all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For those suffering from cancer, that they may feel your healing presence, that you will call into their lives people who can walk with them and strengthen them and give them hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For all who grieve, today we think of Wayne's family as they walk this journey of loss. May all who grieve be comforted by the legacies of lives lived faithfully amid human circumstance, and may they find great hope in the promise of the resurrection. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For those torn by war, violence, and hate-filled action, to find within the Church of your Son a beacon of peace, a place of justice, and an advocate for equity among all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For those who suffer physically, those who suffer the bondage of addiction, that the Church of your Son may be a place of healing and a place of hope. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
For those prayers residing only in the depths of our soul, where there is despair, grant hope. Where there is fear, peace. Where there is a need for reconciling love, may the presence of your Son be known. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We offer all of these prayers in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen.
We now gather all of our prayers together, and we unite them in the perfect prayer that our Lord and Savior gave us. As the good people of Salem United Methodist Church join together and say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever.
Amen. We now bring forward our gifts. Please stand for the doxology. With hearts filled with humility, we offer our lives as well in the service of building your kingdom. Lead us to all who suffer so they may know the reconciling love revealed in your Son. Open our eyes to acts of injustice, persecution, and marginalization. Cause us to stand strong by the power of your Spirit against hate-fueled speech and action. Lead us always to be messengers of the good news of your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. This morning's Old Testament reading is Psalm 139, verses 7 through 12. Where could I go to get away from your spirit? Where could I go to escape your presence? If I went up to heaven, you would be there. If I went down to the grave, you would be there too. If I could fly on the wings of dawn, stopping to rest only on the far side of the ocean, even there, your hand would guide me. Even there, your strong hand would hold me tight. If I said, the darkness will definitely hide me, the light will become night around me. Even then, the darkness isn't too dark for you. Nighttime would shine bright as day, because darkness is the same as light to you. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able for this morning's, I'm sorry, this is not a gospel reading. You don't have to stand for this. This morning's New Testament reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 through 26. Don't you know that all the runners in the stadium run, but only one gets the prize? So run to win. Everyone who competes practices self-discipline in everything. The runners do this to get a crown of leaves that shrivel up and die. But we do it to receive a crown that never dies. So now this is how I run, not without a clear goal in sight. I fight like a boxer in the ring, not like someone who is shadow boxing. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Penny. I said at the beginning of this service, this is going to be a very brief message because we do have a very important presentation today that I want everyone to really engage. Because today in our New Testament reading, we hear about this idea of running a race. And anybody who has ever been a runner, and I was a runner in my early days, I failed miserably at it, but I was a runner in my early days, and I recognized one thing. If you run without a goal, then you have a hard time finishing a race. If you simply set out, and I know many people who start running, just decide, I'm going to go run. And they go and they start out and they're going to make it maybe like 100 yards and all of a sudden they stop. But if your goal was to make it to that 100 yards, then at least you've accomplished that. And sometimes that's the case in Christianity, isn't it? Paul is using an athletic reference because it was something that people could relate to. Athletic games were a big part of culture, even at that time. But he was using that reverence not so much to talk about sport, but to talk about how being a Christian, being a follower of Jesus Christ, is always running a race. And running a race not just with the end result. You know, many times we say, well, the end result is I'm going to go to heaven and all that's wonderful, that's great. But what are you doing here? What are we doing here? What's that marker at 100 yards you're going to want to achieve? What's that marker at a mile you want to achieve? What's that marker at 2 miles you want to achieve? And that's really what this message is all about. That we are called, one, not to sit idly by. And I'm afraid in Christianity sometimes we do that. We believe that all we have to do is walk through these doors on Sunday morning, and the rest of the week we can do as we please. But the rest of the week is where that race takes place. This is just a time to deepen our relationship with God, to celebrate God's love. But carrying God's love into the world is what happens when we walk out into the race, because that's where it starts, when you walk into the world. And when we hear in Psalm 139 that God has searched us and knows us, what does God know about us? Does God know that we are running that race? Does God know that we are running that race in this life? Not just for some goal that's going to happen when we die and pass into eternal life, but are we running that race right now so that we make a difference by carrying Christ to the world? We make a difference by making Christ real in the lives of people. You know, one of the greatest forms of ministry that exists today is the ministry of just being present to someone. And I hear that from all of you when you talk about your joys and talk about your concerns. What a wonderful way to be present, but to be present carrying Christ to people. Carrying Christ to people in ways that give hope, in ways that offer compassion, and in ways that offer strength. That's what this is really all about. So when we talk about, you know, the Apostle Paul saying, run the race, let's not get so caught up in all the athletic metaphors that I and many other preachers have used over the years. Let's talk about what it really means. What it really means is as you walk into the world, it's a race. It's a race to carry God's love to those we encounter. And it's a race to say with confidence, God, you have searched me. And you know me. Does God only know you in church? Or does God know you in a prison? Does God know you in the hospice room? Does God know you with someone suffering a chronic disease? Does God know you with someone suffering a life-limiting illness? Does God know you with someone who needs to feel love? Does God know you with someone who needs to feel compassion? Does God know you with someone who needs to feel justice? That's what God knows about you. I always tell people, and this is something a pastor should never say, God doesn't keep church attendance records, okay? The conference does, we do, God doesn't keep church attendance records. Now, no one leave when I told you that, but God doesn't keep church attendance records. The fact of the matter is, the record that God keeps is the openness of your heart. And if your heart is open to God's grace, then your life is open to reveal that grace. And if your life is open to reveal that grace, then your life is open to touch other people. Now today we're going to have a very special presentation. And I'm going to ask Donna to come up and do the introduction. Some time ago now, probably about 2 years ago, Donna introduced us to Phil's friends. And as you know, we have been supporting the organization financially. But as Donna and I have talked, it's become very much aware there are so many things that this organization does to help and support people. And so Donna.
When I brought up the name of Phil's friends a couple years ago,
I gave a little speech of what I knew about those friends. I went to visit there, and it is so much more than what I could ever say. So I asked Judy Renshaw to please come and explain it. You'd be amazed. Judy?
Thank you, Dad. Good morning.
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 Cancer. Cancer has touched us all, one way or another. It may be in a family member, it may be a friend, it may be a neighbor, it may be your neighbor's niece, but it's touched us all, one way or another. So Phil's Friends is a nonprofit, faith-based organization, ministry, that distributes free care packages to cancer patients all over the United States, children and adults alike. Then once they get a care package from us, they begin to receive monthly cards of hope in the mail, just to let them know that they are not alone. These are acts of the hands and feet of Christ to those that are suffering through that disease. As you know, cancer is not something you just get over in a week. It's not something that, you know, you just take a little pill for and you're all good. It's long suffering, and can be long suffering, and life threatening, and it's scary. It's very scary. And that's what Phil's Friends is about. Phil's Friends was founded by our founder, Phil Zulke. He is a two-time cancer survivor, first diagnosed at age 22, re-diagnosed at age 24. This past summer he celebrated, we praise God, he celebrated his 42nd birthday. He lives in St. Charles, Illinois. He has two, I used to call them little boys, they keep growing bigger. But he was touched by cancer when he was doing some student teaching. He was hoping to be a Lutheran school teacher. And he went 9 months misdiagnosed. By the time they figured out what he had, he was stage 4 Hodgkin's B lymphoma. So he was in a fight for his life. He went through his treatments. He had to go into his classroom, tell his students, you know what, I can't be your student teacher this year. I'm going to have to go and get these treatments and get better. And so he went through his treatments. He heard the words, "You're cancer free." He went back, finished out his degree, was ready to start his first year teaching fourth grade school in a Lutheran school, and the symptoms came back. And he knew immediately what it was. Now, it was during his journey that he received a care package from somebody. And on the outside, they had written all their first names, and he opened up that care package, and it just really meant a lot to him. And then he would receive cards in the mail. The cards would be from people he knew and people he didn't know. And he said, you know, there was days when he couldn't hardly get off the couch. But he knew at noon, the mailman came. And he would work up the energy to get off the couch, go down the stairs, out to the mailbox, and there would be a card. And that card would be maybe from somebody he knew and maybe not somebody he knew, but every time. It had just the message in it that he needed to hear, because that's how God works, right? He gives us those kinds of encouragements. So when he was going through his treatments, he would walk the hallways, and he would have his IV pole with him, and he'd walk in the hallways. And you know, our tendency is to look in the rooms as we walk down the hallway, right? And he'd walk down the hallway, and he'd see that there were people in there, kids and adults who had nobody in that room with them. And he thought to himself, I can't imagine going through this all alone. But then he had moments where he himself felt alone. Now he had a really good support system around him. He had two grandpas who were Lutheran pastors. He had, his parents were both teachers and principals in the Lutheran school. So there was a lot of prayer support and a lot of support around for him. And yet he said, you know what, there were days when I really did feel alone. So it was really on his hospital bed that he just prayed to the Lord and said, Lord, you know, if you see fit to heal me from this cancer, well, first of all, if you feel fit not to heal me from this cancer, I'm ready to go home. But if you see fit to heal me, I'm ready to give my life for whatever you want me to do. He went through his treatments, and he was once again considered cancer-free, and he felt called by God to start this ministry, mimicking the care package that he received in the Cars of Hope. It really started in his basement. The students from his fourth grade class would go, the parents would go into his basement and create the care packages. And the fourth graders would color the Cards of Hope. And it was really through word of mouth that it started to grow. Because again, we've all been touched by cancer one way or another. And we always feel helpless when we hear that diagnosis, whether it's ourselves or to someone we know. And so it started to grow, and it grew from his basement to his garage to a Hope Center in Roselle, Illinois. In 2017, we opened a Hope Center right in Crown Point, Indiana. God provided a place for us. We have a very generous donor who actually pays for our rent to be there. So that was really God saying, yes, this is where you need to be. And so right now, the Crown Point location is actually the home office. Also, it's a Hope Center and a home office. So that is just a little background into how Phil's Friends got started. Now, there are many, many ways that you guys can walk along. I love the prayer, love, give. Prayer is something that we are just enveloped in. We pray over all of our care packages. We pray over patients. We pray for provision, and I'll explain that in a minute. We are now starting up our prayer team. So if you feel that prayer is your gift, and even if you don't feel it's your gift, but you want to be part of the prayer team, please let me know. I'd love to get you on that prayer team. And love. Love is what Phil's Friends is all about.